Let's go ahead and get started. For those of you who I have not met, my name is Mark French. I'm the Director of Coaching for the Recreation Program for Idaho Rush. Thank you all for coming. More importantly, thank you for volunteering to referee your child's game or children's games. Here's how the evening will work. We'll quickly go through the forms that you have in front of you, and we'll go through those things, questions I know you're going to have, that everybody has. It's the same stuff, you know, year after year after year. And we'll get through that fairly short order, and then I will kind of turn it back over to you guys. Hey, what did you forget? Or, you know, you guys can ask me questions. I will point out a couple things. Uniforms, as referees, if you will help us maintain the integrity of the team sport, and by that I mean having people in the proper uniform. So if you're, you know, doing a U8 girls game, for instance, those six or eight players should have yellow on. These people should have white on. Black shorts, black socks. Black shorts, black socks. There you go. It's a disappointment to me when I walk up on a field and there's a kid wearing a red hooded sweatshirt, and another one's wearing a green jersey, and it just looks like people showed up on a field somewhere. It doesn't look like an actual soccer game. So the easy way to fix that, you know, you say, hey coach, can we get that player in a yellow jersey? Oh, well, that player forgot hers today. Well, then she can borrow one of the subs, you know, because the subs don't need a jersey. So just have her borrow one of the subs and she can wear that. And hey, Indy, have her borrow a jersey and they can swap out when the time comes. So that's a pretty easy problem to solve. When it comes to cold weather gear goes on the inside of the uniform. So you'd put your cold weather gear on, your sweats or your sweatshirt or whatever, and then put the uniform over the top of that. And that part's fine. Even if it is underneath something else, any kind of a hooded sweatshirt, can't have it. That's a kind of hazard. We can't have hooded sweatshirts. And the problem is those are very popular right now. So everybody wants to wear a hooded sweatshirt, and just we can't have it. Same thing with snaps, buttons, zippers, anything metal like that. There's some forms right there on the table as you're coming in right there. Those are the ones you need. We can't have anything dangerous like that. Same thing goes for the hair stuff, like the soft scrunchies, or rubber bands, or those kinds of things. Those are fine. Those little plastic claw looking things that girls like to use. You take a ball on the top of the head like that, that will really, really hurt. Jewelry is off for everybody. Wristbands, like the silly band kind of stuff, wristwatches, necklaces, girls with earrings especially, those go out. And the older age groups, you may get someone, oh, well, the hole will grow over if I take them out. Not in an hour, it won't. So take them out, and just pop them right back in after the game. Tape is not good enough. Some people, oh, well, I'll just put a piece of tape over it. Not good enough. Take them out. And that's part of, I've advised the coaches of the same thing, but when push comes to shove, that's your guys' responsibility. Most referees at higher groups will do a formal team check-in where they have the teams line up kind of one at a time a team walks up and the referee kind of goes through, okay, shin guards, yeah, everybody's got good shoes and guards, jewelry, nobody's got jewelry, and, you know, go like that. If you want to do that, that's great. I think it might be a little bit of overkill, but probably it's worth your time to kind of, as they're going through their warm-up, kind of drift through their warm-up and say, yeah, okay, I don't see any problems over there. Oh, hooded sweatshirt. Hey, coach. Can we get this player to take a hooded sweatshirt off, please, and figure out some other way to stay warm? So bottom line, that is kind of you guys' responsibility to make that happen. If there's ever any discrepancy, the home team, which is the team that's listed first on the schedule, wears white. And I'm just kind of picking up some random things here off the bottom of the modifications things. Pass-ins, U6s, U7s, U8s. When the ball goes out of bounds along the touchline, along the sidelines, what people call the sidelines, rather than a throw-in like you normally see in a soccer game, they do pass-ins. All that means is you put the ball down on the floor, on the ground where the ball went out, and the player kicks it back in to restart the game rather than throw it in with their hands. you probably will have to manage that a little bit because people are going to want to stand right on top. Okay, it's your kick in and I'm going to stand right here. Well, you just have them back up just a little bit to let the game get started and kind of go from there. U10s and U12s, do the regular standard, you know, throw-ins. Throw-ins are, for those of you not seen it, 2 feet on the ground, both hands on the ball, over your head like this. Not like this, not like this, two hands over your head like this. You kids will struggle with it, and that's fine. It's a learning league, that's fine. It's part of the reason they're in this program. Give them another chance. You know, kid does one of these numbers, give them another chance. Say, come here, bring the ball back. Okay, try it again. This time keep both feet on the ground, would you? And he'll try it again. If he still can't get it, you'll get it next time. Blue ball, let's go this way instead. You'll get it next time. Just remember to keep those 2 feet on the ground or whatever. Okay, so pass-ins versus throw-ins. Substitutions, this is always the bone of contention everywhere we go, every season we are in. Substitutions should be happening at the quarter breaks only. Only. Okay, now obviously there's some exceptions to that. You know, there's a kid who's injured or is crying or it's really super hot and he's, I can't go on. Okay, well, fine, swap him out. I don't mean to be, you know, hardcore about this. But here's why we do the substitutions on the quarters only, for a couple of reasons. One, it helps the coaches manage their playing time for their players because everyone's supposed to be playing half the game, right? But probably more importantly, if I'm subbing every 2 minutes and she's subbing every 2 minutes and we're subbing the opposite 2 minutes, no one's ever going to play any soccer. It looks like a parade of jerseys coming in and off the field, and the flow of nobody ever gets into the flow of the match at all. The game can't develop any rhythm. So let the kids play for whatever your quarter length is, 8, 10, 12 minutes, whatever it is. Do the stoppage, get 4 new kids on, 4 kids off, restart the game, and go like that. Occasionally you will have a team that is, they show up with only 4 players, or maybe they have 5 players. It's super hot that day. They're playing 4v4. That's super hot that day. They've got 1 sub, and the coach is just adamant that, no, these kids simply cannot run for 10 minutes in a row. Well, okay, A, you're wrong, but I'm not going to make an issue out of it. So if they're hardcore on, I just need to do more subbing than that, see if we can't do it in a subtle way, kind of, sort of, maybe on the fly. Like, ball goes out for a goal kick, and the kid's running to chase the ball, and, you know, bring 1 kid on, 1 kid on, there we go. But it didn't interrupt the flow of the game. It wasn't, like, overt and all that kind of stuff. Here's the problem with the substitutions. When that happens a lot, and people go off the grid a lot, and I mentioned this to coaches the other night. Here's what it says visually to everybody else in the park. It says to the people, everybody else, that coach thinks they're smarter than everybody else. That coach thinks they're above the rules. They don't have to comply with the rules. Everybody else is playing by the rules and doing as they were asked. That person thinks they're so smart and so much better that they don't have to do that. And then I do get the emails on Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday that says, hey, what's the deal? I thought we were subbing just on the quarters. That coach, it was a constant cycle of players in and out of the game. What's the story? So you guys can help manage that as referees. You guys can help manage that, if you would, making sure that it's done just on the quarters. Okay. The question I get all the time on quarter breaks, how do I know what the quarter break is? Let's say you're doing U10s, your quarters are 12 minutes in length. Keep an eye on your watch. You're coming up on, say, about 11:30 or so. Keep an eye out for a natural stoppage of the game. So a ball went out for a throw-in, or there was a goal scored, or whatever, and use that as your substitution break. So you see it, to be about 11:45 or so, ball goes out for a throw-in. Tweet, tweet, tweet. Hey, coaches, substitutions. And let them do their thing for 30 seconds. Once everybody's back in place, then the restart is whatever the normal restart would have been. So go back to that same spot for a throw-in. If the substitution was on a goal, then the restart is the normal. Take the ball back to the center spot and restart from that spot. Okay. Sometimes I see beginner referees, especially, they're kind of looking at their watch like at a hockey game or whatever. And right at 12 seconds, a kid's about to do this and strike the ball. Quarter. Just let the game flow. And if that means that quarter runs over to 12:30 or 12:45 or even 13, that's fine. That's okay. I can live with that. Maybe take a quarter, or a minute off the next quarter or whatever. That's fine. But let's try and keep the flow of the game and make it as natural as possible. One other note about substitutions, and this definitely will be within your control. The substitution break between quarters 1 and 2 and 3 and 4, so not the halftime break, but the quarter breaks right here, those are 30 seconds long. It is run 3 kids on, run 3 kids off, and let's play. So if coaches are wanting to bring their teams over to the sideline during the quarter break, coach, nope, just give the 3 new players. Yep, that's good. All right, let's play. Okay, because a real soccer game doesn't even really have quarters in it. We kind of fake up some quarters just like for the reasons I mentioned earlier. But the quarters do introduce an extra stoppage in the game, and we want to minimize that as much as we can. So don't, if it's, like I said, keep the game on track there. Now the halftime break, obviously, both teams to their benches, do orange slices and pep talks and whatever else that they're going to do. Give them about 5 minutes, maybe an extra minute or two if it's hot. Maybe shorten it a little bit if it's raining and people are miserable and just want to go home, and then roll them back out there and get started again. We'll talk about the proper restarts here in just a second. Minimum number of players. You guys can help manage this as well. Team shows up with, they play 4v4 for whatever reason that day. They've got 3 kids that are out of town or sick or whatever, so they play 4v4, but they only have 3 players. Help the 2 teams work together, that team would loan the other team a player per quarter. Just have them switch shirts, roll over there, play with that team for a quarter. At the quarter break, that kid goes back to his original team. They send him a new player, so the teams still get to play 4v4. The goal is not to, woohoo, we get a forfeit because they didn't have enough players, and then we go home. Nobody wanted to do that day. So kind of manage the, and I've advised coaches of this as well, so everybody, this isn't foreign to anybody, it won't come as a surprise, but if you guys can help manage it, that would be helpful. Playing time's not your issue. Cast and splints, no cast and splints in the rec program. No cast and splints. Even if they wrap it and they've got bubble wrap and foam rubber and everything, it's no cast and splints in the rec program. Well, they let us last week. Well, then you got away with one, but not this week. So that's the recreation. That's the modifications. We're going to go through the sixes and U6s, U7s, U8s real quick. U6s, U7s, U8s. You'll see there's really only 4 things you need to do. And none of them have anything to do with fouls. If you can help the teams remember which direction they're going, which goal they're scoring into, I think that'd be a great help. And if you don't and they forget, it's not the worst thing in the world that happens. The kid scores in the wrong goal. Hey, that was a cracker of a goal. Now go do it in that one down there. All right. Keep the players safe. Again, as it says there, you won't see many fouls. At these younger stage groups, you will see some clumsiness. You'll see kids clattering into each other, tripping over the ball. Occasionally, you'll see a kid take a big swing at a ball and just miss and crack some other kid in the shins. And most times, they hardly even notice, and they just keep on going. And that's good. There's not a problem there. If you do run across the one player, I remember my daughter played one time with a player who had figured out that if she ran like this everywhere she went, no one could ever get the ball from her. And I don't know where she picked that up. It's not like anybody taught her that. She just figured that out. Well, fine, I'm just going to run like this for everywhere. Work with that player. I wouldn't necessarily just tweet on a whistle and call a foul every 12 seconds every time she touched the ball. Work with her. Say, honey, you need to keep your arms down. You can't elbow people. Just keep your arms down and run like a normal. And she'll be fine. Again, it's a learning league. Help facilitate good play rather than, being Mr. Trying to call as many fouls as you can. Again, handball, you probably won't see it very often. Sometimes they'll totally lose their brain and grab it out of the air or whatever. And most of the time they go, "Ooh, sorry." And everybody laughs and thinks it's cute. Just let it go. Most people are going to be okay with that. If you've got the one kid who's picking it up and running around the field with it, obviously you're going to have to deal with that. Manage restarts. This is the part where some people struggle sometimes, is A, knowing what the right restart is, and then 2, being a facilitator of the game. So let's go through what the proper restarts are. Ball in and out over the sidelines. Technically, in soccer, they're called touch lines. They're probably going to be more familiar to you as sidelines. If this is your field, these are the long sides are the sidelines. Ball goes out. It goes to the other team. So if I'm on the red team and I kicked it out, then his white team gets the ball at the point where the ball went out. Okay. And like we talked about, 6s, 7s, and 8s, it's a pass in on the ground. 10s and 12s, it's a throw in. Special note, when you talk about, we live in Idaho, it's going to be windy on days for the older groups, that the ball's in the air. Just FYI, unlike some sports, when the ball, if I hit a ball over distance and the wind's blowing and somehow I'm able to hook it like that and it actually lands here, but it did cross out of bounds, it is out of bounds. It is out of bounds right there, okay? It's not like football, you know, where if it goes out in the air but then it didn't really touch anything but then it came back in, it's still fair. Or baseball, I think, is the same way. Once it crosses that plane and that plane extends all the way out into space, once it crosses that plane, it is out of bounds regardless of what happens from there on. So you'd bring it back to that spot right there where it went out of bounds. So that results in balls out of bounds on the sidelines. That results in a throw in. Balls out of bounds over the end lines are, that's these lines down here. If I'm on the triangle team and my triangle team is going this direction, and that's the goal right there, and my triangle team kicks the ball, let's say I shoot and I miss, the ball kind of goes out this way, it is a goal kick for the circle team inside the goal area there. So typically people put it right there and start. It doesn't have to be there. It can be anywhere inside the goal area, but that's usually where people put it, is right there in the corner for the circle team going the other direction. That kind of makes sense, right? If I kick it out, then you get it. That makes sense. Most people are okay with that. They just kind of lose their brains sometimes on, okay, I know they get it, but where on that part of the field do they get it? The best way to do it is just to use some common sense. Does it make more sense that if I'm the circle team, do I want it here or do I want it here? It's more advantageous for me to have it there, right? So that's where they'd give it, because I'm the triangle team and I'm being punished because I kicked it out of bounds, so the circle team gets it right there. If I shoot and it deflects off of his shin, off the circle team shin, and goes out of bounds there, who gets it? Triangle team that gets it, right? For a corner kick over here. Okay. Again, use some common sense. Obviously, it went off of him, so it's going to be my ball. It's probably too much punishment to put it right there in the middle of the field, right? So we'll start it over here in the corner. Okay. So if it's out on the against the defending team, it's a corner kick for the attacking team. If it's out against the attacking team, the defending team gets it in the goal kick. Don't be afraid to carry this, one of these, in your pocket and just kind of glance at it every once in a while just as a refresher. Okay? Goal kick, when a goal is scored, it comes back. This is, you know, so three triangles. It's 3v3, three triangles here, three triangles here. That's typically how you'd start a game. Actually, you'd have a triangle up there. Circles just scored a goal here, so triangles get the ball back at midfield, and off we go. Technically, ball has to go forward for the game to start. I wouldn't worry about that. You just let the game go. Just get it back out there, place the ball. Okay, you guys ready? You guys ready? Which goal are you guys going to? Good? Which guys are you going? Okay, good, down there. All right, good. Tweet. Off you go. Some referees, I see every once in a while referees trying to manage who is going to take the kick. Not just which team, but which player on the team is going to take a kick or a throw-in or whatever. I wouldn't do that. It's not really your job. And more often than not, it just injects more confusion into anything than anything else. I just put the ball down. Okay, yellow team, it's your ball. You're going to take it? All right. Anytime you're ready, go ahead. White, back up. Okay, go ahead, anytime. And we're good. I wouldn't try and manage. No, you did it the last three times. Let's give it to Ponytail over here. Nah, never mind. She's not very good at it. Let's give it to her over here anymore. Just let them sort it out. Let them sort it out. After goal scored, after a foul is called, all fouls in the recreation program are indirect free kicks. The difference between an indirect free kick and a direct free kick is that an indirect, if it's a direct free kick, and I have my field here, here's the goal here, there's a foul right here, a direct kick, and I'm going to that goal, I can put it in one touch, bang, goal. Woohoo! Okay, an indirect free kick means any other player has to touch it first before a goal can get scored. Any other player, not just my players, but any other players. So if I shoot, I'm playing U10 and there's a goalkeeper here, if I shoot and he touches it, tries to catch it and goes through his hands and goes in the goal, it's a goal. One other player touched it, it's a goal. He probably would have been way too savvy for U10 and U12 players, but at the rec level, but he probably should have just let it go in the goal. Because it would have been it would have gone out of bounds over the end line, and so it's a goal kick going the other direction. Okay, because no one else would have touched it then. So indirect free kicks, another player has to touch it before a goal can be scored. They're all indirect free kicks. So any other player, all the same stuff still applies. Any other player would have had to touch it. Okay. My player, their player, it doesn't matter. Yeah, I was actually at a game last season, and I saw that, and the team's kind of going crazy, and I felt really bad because the kid hit a bomb. It was a great goal, and I kind of called the referee over and said, and I called the two coaches actually both together at the same time too, so they knew what was going on. I called both coaches and the referee and said, here's the thing. It was a great goal, but it really shouldn't have been a goal. It's an indirect free kick, so one other person has to touch it, and I know, Mr. Referee, I know that you didn't really know that, so let's do this. Let's give him another chance to do it, and we'll restart from the free kick right over here, and we'll just give him another chance. Okay, that's what I would do. I thought you meant about giving another chance, but no. Yeah, you're right. The indirect, yeah, there's no changes there, yeah. The definition of indirect is the same in all games, yes. And then the quarter break, we talked about the quarter break. Just find a natural stoppage of the game and just restart the game however it would have normally been restart. And then the last thing for the little guys to remember is managing the time of the game. How many minutes in a quarter do you play? Keep an eye on your watch. Call it at the appropriate time. That's not particularly tough. U7s and U8s, again, almost no difference whatsoever. U7s and U8s, you might find a little bit more aggression. You probably still won't find many fouls per se, but maybe a kid who's being maybe a little bit more aggressive. And you might just drop a word with him and say, hey, slow down a little bit, slow down. You can't crash into people like that, slow down, and see how far that gets you. And if it continues to happen, go ahead and call the foul. I mean, I don't want you to leave the room thinking that I'm saying never call any fouls. What I'm saying is just try and recognize the difference between fouling, persistent fouling, and clumsiness, or just bad luck. Stepped on top of the ball and rolled into somebody else, and you see the pinball, the domino effect, and four other people fall. That's just bad luck. U10s and U12s, that's where it starts getting a little bit more complicated. We do have, I don't know how many of you guys know this, but we do have a pretty major rule change in place for this coming season for U10 players. We're going to cycle back to that rule change at the end. So I'm going to continue to kind of go off of what these sheets say, and then we'll come back to that at the end. 10s and 12s. I'll just go through the soccer has laws of the game. I think there's 17 or 18 of them. And we make modifications to some, not all of those games, so I'm just going to roll through those laws. Law one, the field, you're not going to need to worry about that. Lines are already painted on the field. The ball, make sure that you are, U6, U7, U8, make sure you're using a size 3 ball. It does matter. It does make a difference in the game, so make sure you're using the proper size ball. Same thing at 10s and 12s, they're both using a size 4. Again, make sure it matters, or make sure you are using, because it does matter. Please don't use a 3, please don't use a 5, use a 4. And at all age groups, make sure the ball is inflated. It's a pet peeve of mine when people are using underinflated balls. It's a big pet peeve of mine. it's unworkable when you're using underinflated balls. You may as well not be doing it. It's like trying to play a violin that only has two strings on it. You may as well not do it because it's meaningless. So make sure the ball has enough air in it. Players, again, you're probably not going to have to manage that. Just do a quick head count before you, seven over there. Okay, good. Those numbers include goalkeepers. Speaking of, that's on the next one, player equipment. Uniforms, we've covered uniforms. All players must wear shin guards. All players must wear shin guards. That's the easiest one in the world to fix. If a player doesn't have one, he can borrow a teammate's for that quarter. So that's a pretty easy fix. Cleats, they are allowed to wear cleats at all age groups. They are not required to wear cleats at all age groups. So if somebody wants to wear tennis shoes, that's great. The only warning I would give you about cleats is you might want to take a peek at the player's cleats and make sure that they are not football or baseball cleats. Football and baseball cleats typically have a stud right there at the tip of the toe, or maybe right there on the very, very edge of the shoe as well. Those are pretty dangerous when it comes to a sport where you're in at other people's feet. Now you've got a kind of a weapon right there. Some soccer cleats do have a recessed cleat kind of right in the middle like that, but usually it's a good inch and a half back from the very toe. Football and baseball would be pretty much right there on the very toe. Okay? You probably won't see that very often, but you might. Splints and casts we talked about. Jewelry we talked about. Cleats we talked about. Cold weather gear we talked about. I'll cycle back to goalkeepers. Goalkeepers must wear a uniform that is different than either their team or the opposing team. And I saw a lot of those types of problems last year on U10 and U12 fields where goalkeepers were not in different colors. It doesn't matter what color it is, doesn't matter what the uniform looks like. It can be as fancy as a formal goalkeeper's jersey with the padded elbows and the whole fun. That's fine. That's great. It can be as simple as a training penny. It can be as simple as a T-shirt out of the rag bag at home. It doesn't have to be fancy, but it does have to be different. So girls U10, for instance, it can't be their purple jersey, and they can't just flip it inside out and wear the white side because that's what the other team's wearing. So it has to be blue or orange or red or yellow or pink or stripes or polka dots or whatever. It has to be different from both teams. Okay, and that's both goalkeepers. Goalkeepers, if they want to wear gloves, that's fine. Again, if they're like ski gloves or something, you probably won't see this, but if they're ski gloves, just make sure they don't have like snaps or clips or zippers or whatever on them. Referee, that's you guys. There's not a lot that you guys need to do. Just look the part. Look the part. Look like you came to an athletic event. This young lady over here looks very nice, but she's probably not prepared to do a soccer match. You know what I'm saying? Not necessarily. There's nothing specific you need to wear. If you have a black T-shirt or a black jacket, that's great because that's kind of what referees wear sometimes, black. If you don't, that's fine. But showing up in painter's boots and, you know, camo is probably not the right look. I've seen it. Assistant referees, U6, U7s, U8s, I wouldn't bother. Some people call them linesmen or assistant referees. At a full international match or a full-sided game, they run the sidelines and help determine when the ball is actually out of bounds and who it was off of, and help with offside calls. 6s, 7s, and 8s, you won't need them. Don't bother using them. 10s and 12s, if you want them, you're certainly welcome to have them. I'll give you this caution. Sometimes they cause more problems than they solve. Because here's the expectation. If I'm refereeing a game and I ask these two gentlemen to be my ARs, suddenly everyone in the park thinks these two people know what they're doing. So, and ARs, when you run a game, the ARs typically run, one guy runs this side here, and here's the corner right there, and there's the halfway line, so that's his job. And then this guy over here does this job from there to there, and a referee typically will use this pattern here so that all the fields are covered kind of in an equal fashion. There's eyeballs on everything at all times, basically. If I ask these two gentlemen to be ARs, and I give them a flag, and they all look fancy and whatever, and then they start running from here to here to here to here to here to here with the game, and they put their flag in their back pocket and forget it's even there, and mostly they're just cheerleading, we've set a false expectation. People now think they know what they're doing, and they're like, that guy never did anything. What is he there for? So if you have two people who you think are competent and can get the job done and look kind of like they know what they're doing and have some experience, go nuts. If you are forcibly yanking people out of the crowd and saying, here, do this job for me, you may be setting yourself up for more problems than you're solving. So I'll just give you that warning with assistant referees. Duration of the game, that's pretty simple. That's on your modifications thing. Starts and restarts of the game, all pretty straightforward. It's all the same restarts as the little guys, with the exception of the throw-ins versus pass-ins. One note down there, that last little bullet item there right above Law 9, says on all restarts, the player taking the kick or throw-in may not touch the ball until a second player has touched it. Kind of makes sense, right? If it's a restart there, he can't just pick up the ball and start dribbling all the way down the field. Someone else has to touch it.
Goalies too, right?
Say that again.
If it's a goal kick, goalies can't dribble it.
That's correct. Okay. That's correct. Okay. That's correct. Yeah, the question was goalkeepers on a goal kick, the goalkeeper can't just start dribbling. Not only can a goalkeeper not just start dribbling, but the goalkeeper, the kick itself, so your field will look like this. There's a penalty area and a goal box here. Typically, the goal kick is taken from here. The goal kick has to clear the larger box before anybody can touch it. My team or your team. It has to get out of that penalty area before anybody can touch it.
If it doesn't pass it, do you start over again? Or
yeah.
Do they just kick it to get it out there?
No, start over again. Okay. Tweet. Whoa, wait a minute. Come back here. Remember, it has to leave the penalty area before you can touch it. Okay, let's try that again. Off you go. Okay.
Offsides on the new 10.
We're going to get there. That is Law 11. We're going to get there. Ball in and out of play. You probably will see this at some point. If this is the out of bounds line, the touch line, and it will have some width to it, depending on where you are. Like at Lewis and Clark, about the widest I can get the lines is about 3 inches, 2.5, 2 inches to 3 inches. At Simplot, I think they're roughly 18 inches wide, I think. They've gone crazy with the out of bounds spray paint. They're usually pretty big. But if that's the width of my, I'm going to grab a ball back here. If that's the width of the touch line in soccer, if this is inbounds, and this is where the parents are saying this is out of bounds, in soccer, the whole ball has to be over the whole line for it to be out. So if it's sitting on the line like this, it is inbounds. It is in play. Play on. Play on. Play on. Play on. Out of bounds. Okay? So if it's on the line, and sometimes what you'll see is the kids always say, oops, they'll just stop playing because they think it's out of bounds. And all I would say is, play on. It's still live. Play on. And then they'll go do their thing. Okay? So the whole ball over the whole line, even if it's just like that, it's still on, it's still live. There's still a part of the ball that's still on the line, so it's still live. Okay. Method of scoring. Same thing on the scoring, right? So imagine if this is the goal line, this is the field of play, this is the goal line, and back here is where the net is. Ball comes to die right there. Goal or no goal?
No goal.
No goal. The whole ball did not cross the whole line. Okay, most of the time when you see it, it's what happens is it comes up here and it hits the crossbar and bounces straight down and then back out like that, and then you're in a really bad spot. Was when it bang bang like that, did it? When it hit the ground, was it over or was it on or was it in? And then you kind of goal, woohoo! And you kind of guess and you make the best call you can. That's where an assistant referee would have been really, really helpful, assuming the assistant referee would have been on the line and wouldn't be able to tell you, yes, it was in or yes, it wasn't. So somebody had a question over here, I thought? Okay. Offside. Let's skip offside real quick, and then we'll come back to it, because let's get all the easy stuff out of the way, because offside takes a little while. Fouls and misconduct. You will start to probably to see fouls at U10 and U12. More often than not, it will be a fouls of being clumsy and being late on challenges. So he's got a ball, he's kind of dribbling, he's going to play away over distance. I go in to try and tackle the ball and try and win the ball away from him, and I just get there too late, and I clip him a little bit, and he falls down or whatever. So, again, obviously it's a foul, you blow the whistle, you give him the ball there, and off you go. You probably won't see much, you know, malice and, you know, one of those, and more than anything else, it's going to be clumsy. Note on handball, because it's covered in that fouls and misconduct. Not every time a ball hits a hand is it a foul. And it's and the phrase that we use is it's the difference between hand to ball or ball to hand. So if I reach out my hand to touch a ball and do so, then it's a foul. But if I'm just running, let's say I'm running this way, and a ball is played from behind me, and in my natural running stride, it pops up and hits me in the hand, it's not, the ball came to my hand, so it's not a foul. Technically, when you read the laws of the game, it says in deliberate handling of the ball is the phrase, deliberate handling of the ball. So, it needs to be. Now, at the highest international level, they pretty much say anytime you touch a ball with a ball, it's going to be a handball. Because the theory is that those players are good enough and skilled enough and coordinated enough that your hand should not be in a spot where it would have been hit by a ball. You know, occasionally people will get away with it, especially when it's really close contact like this, but almost every time it's going to be a handball. In your age, in what you guys are doing, it's probably almost the opposite. Almost all of them are going to be accidental. Now, if you have a kid who's running down the field and he's doing this, and he's got no reason in the world to have his hands up in the air, and sure enough, it hits his hands, then, yeah, I'd call it. Because that's not a natural running stride. What are you doing? Put your hands down. But if he's just running along, or if I shoot and Joe's standing right there and it cracks off his hand and he was kind of just in his defensive stance, I'd just let that go. So it's the difference between ball to hand and hand to ball. Ball to hand, not a foul. Hand to ball, it is. Same thing with physical contact. Not all physical contact is a foul. For those anyone who was ever told that soccer is a non-contact sport, you were lied to. It is a contact sport. There should be contact in this sport. Sometimes it's a foul, sometimes it's not. If I am running side by side with this gentleman and we're chasing a 50-50 ball and we're running side by side and we're kind of knocking shoulders like this, kind of side by side like this, it's not a foul. Let him go. Now, if I like that and knock him to the ground, then that's a foul. If I come in from behind him, he's going to be up on the ball, and I come in from behind him and just kind of lean into him with my shoulder or anything like that, then, yeah, that's a foul. Most of the time when I get my hands out away from my body, that's going to be a foul. So if I'm the same situation, he and I are running alongside each other, fighting for a 50-50 ball, and I start getting up here doing one of these, then yeah, that's a foul. But if we're just running like this and I'm kind of, you know, we're kind of down here in a natural running stride, kind of elbow to elbow, shoulder to shoulder, kind of, then that's not a foul. Let the game go. Slide tackles are fair and legal. Part of the sport. It's not necessarily good soccer in most instances. I wouldn't, as a coach, I don't necessarily encourage it because more often than not you want your defenders on their feet rather than laying on the ground. But if a kid, and you will see, especially at 10s and 12s, kids that are savvy enough to figure it out that, woohoo, I like slide tackling. Gets me in the mud a little bit. Mom doesn't yell that my clothes are dirty. I kind of like this. And he'll start slide tackling all over the field. If it's done properly, if it's done not from behind. It's done and in such a way that he wins the ball, you know, touches the ball, gets some contact on the ball, and it's not done in such a way that it's over the top of the ball, right? So the ball's on the ground like this, and his leg goes up and over the top into the opposing player. That's a foul. But if it's in here, hooks the ball like this, and the other player's foot hits like this, and he trips and falls over the ball, it's not a foul. He made contact with the ball here. This kid just lost. I don't know what to tell you. Now, if a player is sliding from behind, I'm dribbling on the ball like this, and someone slide tackles me from behind, not only is that a foul, Please don't give out yellow and red cards. Please, for the love of God, don't give out yellow and red cards. But if there's a kid, and that's pretty dangerous. Slide tackling from behind is pretty dangerous. So if you have a kid who's doing that, I would blow the foul and then say, okay, come here for a second. That is really, really dangerous, and you're going to hurt somebody like that. I'm okay with slide tackling, but it needs to be fair. It needs to be either from the side or from the front. You can't be from behind. You're going to hurt somebody someday. So no more from behind, okay? All right, let's play. So just pull him aside, just a quick word. It's a learning league. Pull him aside, a quick word, and then off we go again. Okay? Couple notes on goalkeepers. Goalkeeper, back when I played in high school, it was totally fair and legal for, I'm a goalkeeper, you're my left back, you could play me the ball and I would pick it up with my hands and that was okay, and then I'd either roll it back to you or punt or do whatever it is I was going to do, and that was okay. A while ago, probably 10, maybe 15 years ago, they changed that so that if you intentionally play me a ball with your legs, your feet, your thigh, your whatever, I cannot pick it up. I have to play it with my feet. I can play it, but I just have to play it with my feet like any other player would. If you head me the ball or chest me the ball, then I can use my hands. That's okay. But if I deliberately play back to my own goalkeeper with my feet, with my legs, he becomes just another field player. He has to use his own feet. He can't use his hands. Deliberately. If it's, you'll see this, I tried to clear a ball and I shanked it. I kind of whiffed and it popped it and kind of went like this, and the goalkeeper runs and picks it up. That's fine. No problem. If I shoot and it deflects off of her shins and my goalkeeper picks it up, fine, no problem. You know, I'm trying to clear a ball. I'm trying to clear a ball going this way. It bangs off of him back over to here and the goalkeeper picks it up. That's fine, no problem. So it has to be deliberately played back to that person, and then she can't pick it up anymore. Okay? If she does, it's an indirect kick from the spot where she picked it up. A couple other things in there that are pretty self-explanatory regarding goalkeepers. Free kicks we talked about. All kicks are indirect kicks. Penalty kicks, there are, because everything's an indirect kick, then there wouldn't be penalty kicks, right? So even if there's a foul in the box, a handball in the box, it's not a penalty kick. It's an indirect kick from wherever the foul occurred. Okay. Throw-ins we talked about. Two hands on the ball, over the head, both feet on the ground. No whipping the ball like this or chucking it one-handed or, you know, that kind of stuff. Goal kicks we talked about. Corner kicks we talked about. So let's tackle the two kind of bigger issues. Offside. First of all, if you are refereeing in the U6, U7, or U8 age groups, you can pretty much tune out at this point because they don't really do offside. What I would say, especially maybe say at U8, if you have a player, most of the time it's not coached. Usually it's the more clever players, the more scheming kind of players. They figure out over time that if this is the field and the stuff is going on down here, if I plant myself down there and the triangles are going this direction, I figure that sometimes players figure out if I plant myself down here, as soon as the ball pops out, all they have to do is pass it to me and I can score a goal. Those of you who have played sports before, it's commonly referred to as cherry picking, because you're just trying to pick the low-hanging fruit there. And we don't allow that. So if you see a player who's doing that pretty consistently, have a word with her, him, and try and get him what I call connected to the play. I'm okay with that. I'm not saying they have to go jump into the beehive. I'm okay with them being outside of the beehive waiting for the ball to pop out to them. What I don't want to see is cherry picking from 30 yards away. So as soon as my team was, I don't even have to think, I just go thunk, and down there, lands at her feet, she turns around, scores a goal. We want better soccer than that. So if you see people cherry picking, and the reverse is true also. So now let's say I'm defending this goal and all the stuff's going down here and I've chosen to put a defender. We don't have goalkeepers in U6, U7, U8, but sometimes either coaches coach it or players kind of figure it out over time. I'll be a de facto goalkeeper. I don't have gloves on. I don't have the shirt on, but I know that if I stand in front of my goal, or even just like 6 yards off my goal, they're hardly ever going to score a goal. It's not good soccer. It's developing habits that I have to break later once they get to higher levels. And honestly, it's not very fun for that player. Because if you're good enough and you can hold the ball down here and it goes down here for the whole period, he may see the ball twice. That's not soccer. That's playing left field. If you wanted to play left field, you'd have signed up for basketball or baseball. Okay, so same thing here. Talk to this player, get him up here, again, not in the beehive, but maybe off the beehive just a little bit, about a pass or maybe two passes away from where the ball is. I call it staying connected to the play. So I maybe have a word with the coach, certainly have a word with the player. Come on, up here. And see if we can't fix that problem. So that's as far down the road as far as offside goes as I want to be for U6, U7, U8s. U10 is a different story. We do start to introduce offside for U10s. And the way I think I want to do this in order is talk about the new rule change for U10s first, and then do offside for both, because the new rule change does affect the offside rule for U10s as well. So those of you who are doing U10s, you should have a sheet that looks something similar like this. It's on the back of this little thing that says laws of the game. That's a written description on the back. That's a written description, and then we'll talk about it right now. So in the past, your field has looked like this. You've got a penalty area, goal box, goal, penalty area. Hopefully I do a better job of painting the field than that. Looks like that, right? We're adding two lines this year, beginning this year. We're going to add a line here and add a line there, which basically divides the field into thirds. So if I'm the defending team, I'm the triangle team down here, I'm defending, this would be the defensive third, the neutral third, and the attacking third. Everybody with me so far? Those lines will actually be on the field. So far, the midline is also on the field. We're trying to get that erased to go away on the U10 fields. This applies only to U10, not U10s and U12s, just U10s for right now. When the triangles have a goal kick down here, none of the circle team can be in my defensive third. Okay? No circles down in this area until the goal kick comes out, clears the penalty box, and is touched by another triangle player. Once that first touch happens, circles can send one player into the area to play defense until the ball comes out of the defensive third, and now it's game on. You can do whatever you want, wherever you want. And the goal is that we want to avoid intentionally creating situations where we create 50-50 balls. Boot it, soccer. We've all heard parents do that. Boot it! It's terrible. Nothing tips you off as a beginning soccer family than screaming boot it at a soccer field. It's terrible soccer. It's terrible, awful, dreadful soccer. It doesn't serve any point or purpose whatsoever. We want to train our players to build an attack out of the back. Own the ball, possess the ball, play to feet, so we can build an attack starting in the back and working our way forward. If we don't do things like this, then we start just with a regular goal kick, well, what happens on goal kicks 95% of the time, 90% of the time? They kick it as hard as they can down here, and it turns out to be a 50-50 ball somewhere down there. We may get it back, but we may not. So we want to create a comfort zone, basically, in the back where the goalkeeper feels comfortable and confident of being able to play out for at least one pass, right, so we can get out of the back. So again, goalkeeper takes the goal kick. It comes out of the penalty area, which is good. They get one touch, and then a circle player can come in and pressure the ball. And then once it comes out, then anybody can do anything you want. This applies to goal kicks only. It does not apply to punts, goalkeeper punts. It does not apply to throw-ins, corner kicks, indirect free kicks, none of that kind of stuff. It applies to goal kicks only. I mentioned touch here versus reception. Everybody sees the difference, right? a touch could be off my kneecap and out of bounds, right? A reception, it could be, you know, off the inside of my foot and I have to go get it again. And on my third touch, I finally corralled the ball and I'm good to go. We're not going to give them three touches, they get one. So if this player, if this circle player, the kid takes a touch here, the circle player comes in and somehow he's able to win the ball and go to goal, then everything, everybody can go anywhere they want. Any restrictions are off. Takes a bad touch here, goes out of bounds, everybody's in, you can do whatever you want. Is that clear? Does that make sense? It's a pretty big change administratively, because if your parents don't know about it, then what you end up having are, you know, a bunch of people sitting over on the sidelines here and yelling at the circle players, why don't you guys go play defense? Go win the ball. And the poor circle players going, well, I'm not allowed to. Go mark that player so he can't get it. No, I'm not allowed to. And as soon as he touches the ball, then we can send one player. And how come not all of you go? Come on, everybody. No, I can't. It's just one player. So we need some education here, and that's coming mostly from the coaches. And that we should be okay on that. If they do, for whatever reason, they lose their brain and they start sending multiple players in, I would have a little bit of latitude to start the game, you know, to start maybe the first game or two, feel like a little confident to say, whoa, stop. Remember, only one at a time, right? Let's try that again. We'll try that with the goal kick back here again. Now, if they came in and it didn't make any difference at all, for some reason they came in and they did over there, then just let it go and just remind him and let the play go on. So the way that this all ties into the offside, which is what we were talking about, is that these dotted lines, the third lines, become hard offside lines. Okay, well, I take that back. Partially become hard offside lines. How many people watch hockey or know hockey? Be very similar to an offside here. Ball has to enter that area before a player can. Just like over the blue line, the puck has to cross the blue line before the attackers can go in. Same idea. It's a hard offside line. Below here, however, it still is a floating offside line, even with the last defender. Okay? For those of you who don't know what I'm talking about, hold on, because we're going to talk about that right now. So, offsides. Offsides is probably the most difficult thing for soccer parents, players, referees, coaches, everybody to understand. I can't go a week, I can't go 2 weeks without hearing somebody on TV, broadcasters, misinterpret the offsides because they didn't get it, they didn't understand, they missed a call. I'm not talking about just missing a call, which is going to happen, that's fine, I'm not have a problem with that, but just like not even understanding. Oh, that player wasn't offside because blah, blah, blah. No, he was offside, or vice versa. It happens all the time. Here's how offside works. I'll say it slow. I'll say the magic sentence slow, and I'll repeat it again. A player is offside when there are less than two defenders between him and the goal when the ball is played to him. So there has to be two defenders between him and the goal when the ball is played to him, or you're offside.
Does one of those defenders include the goal?
Usually, yes, but it doesn't have to. Occasionally, you'll see crazy things. Goalkeeper comes off to his line to go catch a ball at the top of the 18 or something, so another defender drops in behind him, and so they still have two defenders, just one of them wasn't the goalkeeper. Almost always, though, it's going to be the goalkeeper. So as you're adjudicating this on the field, as you're doing this on the field, really what you're kind of keep track of is count on the goalkeeper being there most of the time. You're going to be most, and then really what I'm looking at is the last defender. So if Indy is the goalkeeper, really what I'm looking for is where is Joe, because he's the next to last defender, and then where is this gentleman in relation to Joe? Because if this gentleman is trying to score in that goal down there, is he onside or offside right now?
He's
onside, because there's Joe is one defender and Indy is another defender. There's two between him and the goal. reverse that. He's the last defender, and Joe's the attacker, offside or onside? Offside. Offside, because there's only one defender between him and the goal. There are a couple exceptions. Aren't there always?
Yes.
You cannot be offside on your own half of the field. So if I'm on the triangle side down here and I'm attacking down this direction, and for whatever reason, the circle team pulls all of their players up and they've got all their players down here and I'm standing right there, I cannot be offside. Regardless of where the second to last defender was, I'm on my own half of the field, I can't be offside. Okay? More likely than not, which you probably won't see that, but what you will see occasionally is goalkeeper is still down here where he normally is, but the second to last defender somehow lost his brain and went over here like this, leaving that player unmarked. And when we play him the ball, then it just looks weird because there's not two defenders there, but he's totally okay because he's on his own side of the field. Okay, so that's one exception. You cannot be offside when you are dribbling the ball. So if he's the second to last defender, Joe's the goalkeeper, I beat him on the dribble, and now there's only one defender between him and the goal, right? But it's still not offsides because I have the ball. I'm dribbling the ball. I've seen people make that call, and everybody in the park goes, ah, no. Okay, so when I'm on the ball, I'm dribbling the ball. I can't possibly be offsides, which kind of makes sense because if I'm dribbling the ball is always in front of me, right? I cannot be offside if I'm behind the ball. So here's what you will see. So triangle guy is dribbling. Goalkeeper comes out to try and make the save. Second to last defender has fallen down and broken his leg here. So there's really only one defender between him and the goal. Dribble. Pass here for me to run on and shoot and score. There's only one defender between me and the goal, right? I'm offside, right?
No.
Why? I'm behind the ball. I can't possibly be offside. I'm behind the ball. Okay? So you had that. Yeah, you're right. I'm not offside. And you will see that. You will. I mean, hopefully you won't see the kid fall down and break his leg, but you will see players behind the ball not be offside. It's going to look weird because there's only one defender between him and the goal, so it's going to look weird, but you got to judge, was he behind the ball or not? And if he was, then he's not offside. For clarity's sake, when I say between, so here's the circle goaltender, here's the second to last defender, but the person in question, the attacker in question, is over here, that player is between you and the goal. So technically he's not on a line between you and the goal, and that's really not the point. Even if he's clear over here, he's still between you and the goal. He's, okay, doesn't necessarily mean he has to be doing a job over here. So if you watch soccer on TV, what happens is the AR pretty much pins himself to that last second to last defender. And then as this guy moves up and down the field like this, the AR moves alongside of him like this. And he's always in line. So it's easy to see, was she on this side of the second to last defender, or was she on this side of the last defender? And then it's easy for me, onside, offside. You're not going to have that advantage because usually you won't have the ARs. Here's the problem that most people struggle with. I kind of saved it to the last. When do we judge whether that person was onside or offside?
As soon as he touches the ball.
It's when the pass is made.
Yeah. Yeah, when the ball is played to him. Not when he receives it, not when he touches it, when the ball is played to him. So if that's my teammate, I've got a ball there, last defender is there, well, second to last, goalkeeper's back. That's, for this conversation, let's always assume that the goalkeeper is home. There's the second to last defender. Here's my teammate here. I'm dribbling the ball here. Offside or onside?
Offside.
Why?
You
saw me shake my head, that's why, Indy.
Well, because
I haven't played him the ball.
You haven't touched it.
I haven't played it. No. I haven't played him the ball at all.
Oh.
I'm still dribbling. I haven't played him the ball. He is in an offside position, but he's not offside. He hasn't involved himself in the play yet. As soon as I release a ball to him, now he's offside. See the difference? He's not offside just because he's hanging up there. He's offside when I play him the ball. He's not offside when he receives the ball. He's offside as soon as I play him the ball. See the difference? It's a big difference. And the way it's, this is pretty easy. That's pretty easy to pick out. What's gonna, the part that is people struggle with is this. Here's the most difficult call in soccer. I've got the ball here. Second to last defender there. My teammate is there. Makes a little looping run around there. I play him the ball. Well, actually, let's put him on the right side of the field. Attacker there, second to last defender there. I've got the ball here. Makes a run here. I play him a ball. Offside or onside?
Offside.
You can't tell from that drawing.
Because
you don't know when I played him the ball.
If you played him the ball before he passed him, it'd be fine.
Right.
If you played him the ball after?
If I played him a ball and then he started his run in behind, he's great.
That's fine.
If he starts his run in behind the and then I play him, he's off.
Probably off.
So your job is to keep track of three things simultaneously. Where's the second to last defender? Where's the attacker? And where's the ball? And when did it get played? And where were those two in relation to each other when the ball was played? Make your lives a whole lot easier if the judgment was made when he received it, right?
Yeah.
That makes it a whole lot easier. But that's not how the law works. Right. So if you think of it in that way, if you think of it as here, I'm keeping track of three things simultaneously. Where's the second to last defender? Where's the attacker? Where's the ball? And when was it played? That answers all your questions. Yeah? So I have to take that snapshot as soon as the ball was played. Take a snapshot. And in my mind, yep, okay, good, he was onside. What happens over here doesn't really matter because the part that matters is when the ball was played. After that, it's all secondary. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Who's struggling with offside? Anybody?
All you have to worry about is one defender in the goalie, really, to decide offsides, right?
That statement is true whether they play nine defenders.
Okay.
It doesn't matter. Really, all you're concerned about is the last two.
Okay.
Where are the last two defenders, usually a goalkeeper, and then the next to last defender, and where are they in relation to the attacker? So the reason we got here was this line here. Remember back when I said that you can't be offside on your own half of the field? You can't be offside on the own two-thirds of the field now. So take this line out, and this is the line that matters now. So that's the hard offside line, and then inside of that area, it's regular floating, where was the second last defender, blah, 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 blah. Does that make sense? So basically, we're just moving that line to there and to there simultaneously. That has subtle implications for the rest of the game as far as the way we coach it and what the players are able to do, because now if that's we're moving the offside line closer to the goal, which takes away that much space, which means I'm going to play fewer big balls over the top and hope my big, fast, strong runner latches onto it and scores a goal. So basically, I'm killing the attacking space behind the back line, which makes me play more possession soccer now. All of that is a whole lot of coach speak of saying that there's a developmental reason we did it this way. Who has questions about anything? Yeah.
Are all the coaches aware of that, though?
This?
Yeah.
The coaches, here's what we've done.
All the U10 coaches aware of
that. Here's what we've done with the U10 coaches so far. Demanded that they all be here, and so far I see actually one of them who's actually here. The other thing, earlier this morning, I gave them an option to opt out. If they watch a very similar video to this that we did last week, I sent them a link to that. If you watch this video and you understand it, then you don't have to come tonight. So the coaches are going to know about it. They should know about it.
Oh, so they were supposed to come tonight to...
Right.
It's after this, though.
Yeah, it's after this. It's we go 6 to 7:15, and they're supposed to be 7:15 to 8:30 or something like that. Yeah. So they should be coming after this. I don't know what kind of attendance we're going to get, but we'll try. And then the follow-up on that is that we'll send that link to that video to all the parents as well tomorrow morning, so at least they can watch it and to avoid the parent on the sideline screaming issue.
Okay, so what do we do about the first game on this Saturday because the kids don't
know? I would recommend, honestly, if it were me, before you start your game, grab your coaches and ask them, do you guys know the new rule change? Uh-huh. And they say yay or nay. If they don't know, find out how to get them. Have the other coach explain it to them or something.
Right.
Yeah,
honestly,
I agree.
That's what I would do.
I agree.
The players won't know. They'll
know. Like my players already know.
Yeah.
I told them today.
They should know.
The coaches got the information this morning. And was there maybe enough time to go over it in three different training sessions? No. It's a pretty simple concept.
Okay.
So it's no different than the restrictions you might put on a team during a training game, for instance. Coaches do that all the time. It's a zonal game, and the reds can't go into that area, or the greens only get two touches, or whatever. It's called a restriction in a training match. So the coaches should treat it just like a regular restriction. You can't go in that area. They can only send one player. We can only send one player in once they take a touch. Once it comes out, we're great. Presumably, other than the occasional brain fart, kids should pick that up in less than 5 minutes.
Yeah.
A couple, three times. If you're the triangle team, after the first two or three times you take a goal kick, I'm going to get it. I should be get it. I may forget every once in a while, but at least I'll understand it.
Okay.
Yeah, I'm not completely worried about that. What other problems or questions do people have about refereeing? Yeah.
Now, this is U10 only.
U10 only.
U12.
That's correct.
Okay.
U12 is straight up regular soccer. Okay. And at U8s and below, it really doesn't matter at all because we don't use offsides and all that. They can't kick it that far anyway, and it doesn't apply to U8s and below.
Thank you.
I mentioned it to the coaches the other night, just to be on the safe side. In theory, you could see a situation where triangles are down here. I've got a goal kick. I'm up by a goal. I've got 3 minutes to kill in the game. Guess what? I'm going to put all my triangles down here, and I'm just never going to take the ball out of the area. And now it's 1v7 in this area. Look how clever I am. I hold the ball for 3 minutes. We win. We go home. Don't do that. I've told the coaches, don't do that. And if you see it being done as a referee, go talk to the coach. Say, be better than that. You guys can take charge and say, be better than that. That's not why the kids came today, is to see how clever the coach was. I don't expect that would happen, but I need to say it just in case. Anything else? You're all world-class referees now? One last note. Not so much a problem with the adults that are here in the room. Occasionally, we have young referees, kids that want to be a referee at 12 or 13 or 14, whatever. And I think they're fine, especially because they're players themselves, so they understand the game and they get it and everything. The one problem where they especially struggle, and occasionally adults struggle as well, is own the field. Be the guy in charge. Be the girl in charge. Have a strong whistle. Let kids know I'm in charge. Help them with the restarts. Collect the ball. Put it right there. Yellow team, next time you touch it, we're live. Let's go. Help them dig the ball out of the back of the net when a goal gets scored. Trot them back to the midfield line. Plop the ball down. Okay, you guys good? All right. You guys are good. You know which direction you're going. Okay, let's play. Tweet, let's play. Where it kind of breaks down and where everybody kind of gets frustrated is when I'm more interested in looking at my text messages or my whistles. Hey, hey. Nobody stopped? Okay, play on. That's when everybody starts getting frustrated. Players get frustrated, fans get frustrated. Even if you make a mistake, everybody's going to forgive you. As long as you're in there and you're trying and you're doing your best, and most people are really cool about you. Lost your brain, and you gave. I've seen this happen before. You give the attacking team a corner kick from right there, bang, goal, woo, right? But you've just lost your brain. And usually, what happens is, as you set that up, people go, whoa, stop. The corner kick comes from over there. So if you guys have an open mind on that and kind of not be get your backs up all bristly and everything, kind of go, oh, wait a minute. You're right. All right, sorry, my bad over there. I really, really, really doubt you're going to get anybody complaining about the quality of the officiating. A lot of people are hesitant to be an official because they don't want parents and fans yelling at them. I've never seen that in our rec program. I've just not seen it. I'm not saying it doesn't happen, but I've never seen it, especially not to those people who are doing their best. They're in, they're cracking, they're doing their best, and they just maybe make a mistake every once in a while. I think you're going to be fine.
You're fine to ignore them.
Yeah.
Honestly, you do.
Yeah, you just. Yeah. So that would be my only other kind of piece of advice, not so much a rule, but a piece of advice. Own the game, be on top of it, be a presence, help manage the game, and you'll be fine. Find some sort of a whistle. I used to have whistles that I'd give you guys, but we ran out and I don't have any more. A whistle's great. Cell phones are terrible. Some guy put an app on his phone. He pushed the button and it was supposed to be some kind of air horn sound, but you couldn't hear it further than this far away, and he was trying to use his cell phone. Don't do that. One guy, I thought it was really funny though, one guy was using a duck call.
Quack,
quack. And so I'm on this field and I'm looking at, every once in a while, I'm on this field watching my daughter playing over there. Quack. All right, what the? And finally I looked over and it was him. It was hilarious. It sounded like someone was stepping on a duck every once in a while. Train whistle will be fine, whatever. Just make sure that they know that, you know, here's why and how we stop. Yes, Vanna White.
Who is that anyway? I don't know. I'll show you today, dear.
You had a question, my dear?
Uh-huh.
Sure, absolutely. Some people do that because they're afraid that they don't want to drop it. Real high-level referees use one, and they'll even have two whistles attached to the same thing in case one breaks in the match, so they don't have to go find another one. They've got another one right there. Some I've seen some that are like rings like this, and they just run around like this, and there's a thing on the top. So every time they like that.
My mom carries like 40.
Sweet. She should pass them out at the fields then. Questions? Anybody else? Okay, anytime you need anything, you've got a question, whatever, you know where to find me. Send me a quick email, give me a call, whatever. I appreciate you doing it.
Thank you.
Thank you, guys.